And rather than narrate all of this, which of course would take all the time we have, I'd like to emphasize some of the things that I find particularly not just instructive, but inspirational in the work that Mike has done. And to start with the breadth of activity from government to academics to administration. It's different venues all demand a lot. But going beyond that, within his academic work, what Mike does is present clear pictures of complex situations. Doesn't deal with individual sort of spotlighted issues. He deals with overall pictures and then presents clearly in his whole series of books, and leading to things like same bed, different dreams, which I think everybody is, I mean, that's one of the more common phrases in US-China relations. And I don't know if you got it from somewhere, but you certainly made it.
Cohen's an old Chinese chung yu, right?
Oh yeah, right. Okay, well, you brought it into English anyway. But that frame, taking the complex situation seriously, and taking a complex place as complex as China, and a relationship as triply complex as the US-China relationship, and then trying to figure out what are the important aspects of that, and bringing those together. I think the person most comparable to Mike in this respect, I think, is Harry Harding, who also has that talent for taking a complex issue and bringing out
the... We were tung shui at Stanford.
Aha. So this may be a Stanford.
Harry taught me.
I know. Harry. So I don't know if this is an argument for us all going to Stanford. But your daughter went to UVA.
Yes, she did. And my son-in-law.
Okay, very good. So that's an important aspect. And I'm not going to, I know that Mike's going to be concentrating on his book, Rivers of Iron, which is about the rail system that China, the extension or the proposed extension, that partially implemented extension of that rail system into Southeast Asia. So I'm not going to concentrate on that. I would like to say a few words about his next book, which is an autobiographical account of the development of US-China relations from the 1960s to the present, because he's been involved in the relationship for that entire time. And I can't give away the conclusion to it, because 2023, who knows? it starts with him working his way through Stanford as a fireman. And that whole problem of, you know, a fireman putting, you know, not knowing what crisis will be there, but working to resolve the crisis. And I think that fireman approach to the US-China relations is something that all of us appreciate his personal contributions to. And all of us know that at the present time, there are even bigger fires going on and possible expansions of those fires, which makes the work that he does and the approach that he takes to that work even more valuable for us to be listening to. So without further ado,
thank you for that generous introduction. And I'm so glad you all overcame the opposed attractions of whether it be pastry, a lovely day outside, all the other things you could be doing. So it gives me a chance to talk about something I'm really interested in and want to get a lot of feedback from you. So enough of all that. Thank you, Brantley, for the invitation, East Asian Center as well. And as I say, all of you coming here, already said that my daughter went here and my son-in-law, although my daughter came here because my future son-in-law was already here. So a little side story on that. And also, as I've said, I know Harry Harding and his wife Shirley are in Taiwan, but I wanted to recognize them and our longstanding friendship an intellectual colleague relations, and wish him the best, and so forth. So enough with that. I wanted to talk about this recent book, Rivers of Iron. And I just might say where the topic came from and to make a general point. And that, I think, in research, actually getting on the ground and talking to people is an important thing to do. I'm not saying other approaches don't have merit, that they don't produce insights that just talking to people produce. But in the end, they add complexity to your view of why things happen as they do. And this title reflects an interview I had in Vientiane, and I say I should make clear that my co-authors, one from Singapore and one from Malaysia, both prior PhD students, as it works out, were indispensable and equal partners in all respects. So this isn't just tacking on names. This was a genuine three-part, full contribution partnership, and I want to make that clear. But anyway, I might slip into I or me or whatever, but it should be properly we. But in any case, we had an interview with a planner in Vientiane, practically the first day. We ultimately went from Bangkok by ground along the route of one of three rail lines proposed up to Bo Tien on the Chinese border. And it was a remarkable, to me, trip, partly because I came to learn a lot more about Southeast Asia than I ever know. But first day in Vientiane, the sort of still dusty capital of of Laos. And we met with the planner in charge of transportation for Laos. And he started off, I think he probably looked at us as saying, well, this is just another group of Americans or outsiders coming to see how the Chinese have got this poor little country wrapped up in debt trap diplomacy, and it's all about China and strategy and this. And I think he took as his mission to give another view. And some people might say I'm too quick to adopt other views. But he said, think back to great civilizations. Almost all of them started either on a coast or a major river. They had transportation. They could reach beyond themselves. They were natural arteries of development and communication and trade. Greek islands, right? So he said, they had their rivers and their oceans. But we have to build our rivers of iron. We have to, with infrastructure, build what God and nature gave others. And I was blown away by the breadth of that vision. Now he says, we're going to have to borrow a lot of money. And I don't know exactly where we're going to get it. But just imagine if our trade, imagine that we're a little toll booth and all this freight and passenger is moving along through us. And we have one thing here, location, location, location. I'll get to that in a minute. But if we can capture 5% of that flow through, we're going to be in a very different position than we are. And the safe course of not borrowing a lot of money from the Chinese is do nothing, stay where you are, and you're going to stay poor. I want you to understand that's our position. Now you can write that off as communist apology, any number of things that you might take the rough edges off that. But in various versions in this region, I take that to be a serious proposition. And so what we wanted to do, and you might ask where this idea came from, and what is the idea? And what is the vision? The idea is to hook southern China, starting in Kunming, but Kunming is the railhead that connects to the rest of the Chinese high-speed rail system, to connect Southeast Asia to China and its 30,000 kilometers of high-speed rail. more than any other country in the world, and it built it in from about 2000 to 20, let's say 2013, just to give a decade plus to this. So the vision is hooking China's system into seven continental Southeast Asian countries. As it turned out in studying it, we also had to consider Indonesia, because Indonesia had negotiated a deal and it fit into the negotiations in the rest of Southeast Asia, even though it wasn't going to connect anytime soon to Indonesia. So this is the question, really, is the politics of going global with infrastructure. And a number of questions, it seems to me, arose about that. Or, first of all, first question is, could China do it? Those seven countries, those seven Southeast Asian continental countries may on a map kind of look all kind of similar, right? But they are each very different political, social, and economic systems. So the first thing when you start talking about a network is, can China deal with seven different situations? Is it flexible enough? So can China do it? What are the Chinese, second, what do the Chinese people think about it? I mean, in many respects, there are a lot of poor people in China that in their own mind could spend money a lot of places besides Laos. So there are Chinese people that are actually asking, what are the opportunity costs of dumping all this money and infrastructure, not only in Southeast Asia, but Pakistan or Africa or Central Asia? I mean, how much money are you going to make going through Uzbekistan, Tajikistan? So there is real debate. What's the debate in China about this? Another set of questions the book deals with. You know, here China went from, we'll say it's not exactly true, but it's true in spirit. In 2000, China had 0 miles of high-speed rail. In 2013, it had over 20,000, and as I said now, last time I checked, 30,000 kilometers of rail. How did China do two things? Build the industry that could create the hardware for this, and then how did it build this in what I would take to be a fairly short period of time? Which brings you to industrial policy. I'm at SAIS. We're great on international economics, comparative advantage, let the market determine. That's be the basic shared, I don't want to say ideology, but our view. But that biases you against industrial policy. But if you look at the United States history, Transcontinental Railroad in its own era, that was industrial policy. It had lots of corruption, lots of this and that, but it transformed the power position of the United States. NASA, blowing up asteroids. I mean, all of this is a government focus. We got a big role for private sector as well. So the book is really also deals with this issue, does industrial policy work? Do we need to, in response to China's building this network, get more industrial policy ourselves? And I don't mean our answer, but our instinct is the US needs more industrial policy. And you can see the US moving that direction in a number of ways with appropriations and so forth. But one of those things is in the course of the book, the U.S. adopted the policy of what's called the Build Act of 2018, appropriating money largely out of the desire to compete with China into Asian infrastructure projects. We haven't actually spent very much money, and I think there's a lot of rhetoric, and so we can talk about the reality. But the point is, as we define China as a technological, economic, and strategic competitor, I think we're being driven towards more industrial policy. I think a whole another set of questions is how do we think about doing research now on China? My whole, but the approach I had the opportunity, given I came into the field after Nixon visit, China opens up and only, let us say, 2013, 2014, begins this process of constraint a bit. I was able to study China from the inside out, to put a name on it, interviews, getting into archives, using China to learn about China from the inside. Well, I think those opportunities for at least outside Westerners are diminishing over time. And this project occurred in a period when I was lucky. Another thing that comes through is the role of luck in research. Here I had essentially the seven Southeast Asian countries, Indonesia and China. And we could have interviewed in any of those countries in a random order. But for some reason, anyway, we started with China. And that was in 2015, and China was still relatively open, and COVID hadn't happened, and all of the intervening things. And so really had remarkable access in China to bureaucrats, planners, and not least because they were proud of HR. They were proud of this. You know, when I said, how did you do it in 13 years? They're proud of that. So it was self-evidently not a topic designed to humiliate China. That's, I think, and how they look at your purpose. Need a Moody Shusham, right? Very important. Now, I didn't design this to make the Chinese happy with the topic. I thought it was an intrinsically important topic. And how did they build this so fast? And how did they begin to convert this into an export industry? And one of the interesting things about how did they build this so fast is they had a really smart minister of railroads, which brings up a whole nother thing, the importance of leadership in sub-organizations. And it's not just Xi Jinping and everything's about Xi Jinping. In fact, this whole thing started with Jiang Zemin and was carried forth by Hu Jintao, and Xi Jinping is just a beneficiary of something that was conceived and built before he came along. So in any case, how did China do it? And this smart minister, Liu Zhijun is his name, called Great Leap Liu, which of course he had this Great Leap mentality, which has its downsides. He was eventually purged for corruption. But how he got that system to focus and concentrate resources and carry this out is a wonderful story in how a human can shape a political objective. I don't have a one-man theory of this whole thing, but he is very important. So in any case, how did he do it? He basically said, we are going to lure the Japanese, the French, particularly the French, the Swedish, the West, Canada also fits importantly. They are the leaders in this technology. And how are we going to get them to part with their technology? And not only part with the technology so we can use it, but also so we have the right to build our own brand name. You know, Xiehe, Harmony brand. Now the Renaissance is the new next generation. But China talked the Europeans and the Japanese and the Canadians into parting with their technology. And actually, well, one French observer observed we made a mistake. We didn't think the Chinese could reverse engineer all of this. But Liu negotiated the deal with the outside technological powers. You will have in the short run with us building our system. We will buy at your technology legitimately, and although they did steal some, it's not quite as clear as I would make it, but the basic proposition was we will buy your technology, we will trade temporary access to our market for that period. But we need to have the right to replicate it and ultimately not only use it in China, but sell it abroad. And the Europeans, and you might say we're short-sighted enough, if that's the way you want to put it. Not sure it's the way I'd put it, but in any case, they were attracted to that deal, thinking China, we're just a moving, technologically, we're moving at X speed and China's at half X. They're never catching up, don't worry about it. Well, they are worried about it now. So you can argue, but the point is he looked at the international market and said, what does it take for China to compete? And I'm willing to do it. And they did. And it's a lot more than it was almost a Manhattan scale project. I forget the numbers, 50 some research institutes working on different aspects of all this switching technology, propulsion technology, just how you keep the train on the tracks going at the speeds that it does. So it's a really interesting set of questions, very broad, but I think it raises the whole issue of we should not make the mistake of underestimating when China focuses, it can accomplish things. The second set of, so that's one whole broad set of questions. The second set of questions is, okay, we got this Chinese juggernaut that created this system. Are the countries to southeast, to the south of China, are they just putty in the hands of China? China makes a proposition they can't resist. Here it comes. And a lot of the study, and this is where my colleagues really help, they have agency. To look at all these seven countries as just victims of Chinese power, numbers, money, and technology. I don't mean all countries in Southeast Asia have equal agency. Generally speaking, Laos has less. I would say Thailand has enormous leverage. Singapore, little old Singapore, has got a lot of leverage. So you go country by country, but you have to ask yourself, what gives these countries capacity to shape Chinese behavior in their borders? And there are a lot of things that give them capacity. First of all, there's strength in numbers. There's ASEAN. ASEAN has a development connectivity plan. Came out in 2010, was revised in 2016. And ultimately, a railroad has to hook up at each of these borders. Now, that raises the issue of what is actually being proposed here. And what's being proposed is three lines going to Singapore. So, Kunming to Singapore. And if you look at the map, I brought one, but it vanished on my flash drive. So I can't show you the map. But if you just visualize that, Kunming, southern China, down to Singapore, you've got Vietnam, basically, and Cambodia off to the east. You have what's the Chinese and everybody calls the central line, going from Kunming down to Vientiane, and then Nong Khai and on to Bangkok. And then to Singapore. That's the central line. That's what's the furthest developed. They just, at the end of 2021, opened the Laos line, which we went along as they were constructing it in 2017. So you already have the line to the Thai border operational. So that central line, you then have a potential line through Vietnam and Cambodia going to Bangkok. And then you have a Western line, potential, part a little bit built, going through Myanmar, then going to Bangkok, and then shooting down the Malay Peninsula once again. So that overlapping line from Bangkok through Malaysia and down to Singapore. So you're talking about three lines. And so one of the fascinating things is, you learn a lot by looking at a map and saying, what does the ground dictate? unless you're going to move all the ground and all the people, you got some constraints. And that three-line structure creates a negotiating problem for China, because it has to decide which route do we go, or which combination of routes, and who's it going to be easiest to negotiate with. But on each of these lines, you have multiple countries, at least more than one, which means you have to reach a sequence of deals. So, for example, when I talked to the Lao planner, I said, why are you assuming all this debt? And I explained part of that. But he said, frankly, the Chinese told us, if we don't cut a deal, they're going to go to Vietnam on the east, or they're going to go to Myanmar on the west. We, the Chinese, would prefer first to go through Laos because it's the direct route. We believe it will create the most momentum for further development downline fastest. And frankly, for the Chinese, dealing with Myanmar has its problems, and dealing with Vietnam really has its problems, which we can go in. So we, the Chinese, would rather go through Laos, but if you don't want to play ball, okay, we'll go through one of these other routes. And he said, that presented us with either get involved or lose, stay poor. China didn't actually threaten. China just stated the structure of the situation as it saw it. And as I would say, the Laos drew the conclusions. Now, that raises the issue too. Okay, so say the Laos say no. We go through Myanmar. We go through, it's unstable in much of there. In fact, Chinese provide weapons to the population, the insurgent population in the Shan states, and so forth. So we have some insurgency problems. There are human rights problems that we'll get entangled in, the Rakhine state and all of this stuff. So that's a problem. If Vietnam has a lot of experience with China, it doesn't all encourage it to high levels of cross-border integration. So we'd rather go through Laos, but we will try to, ultimately they want to do all of these things. And their vision is that if we get one thing going, that creates an incentive for at least several others to join the system, because they want ultimately access to China. And we've already built that first line down to the Thai border. And now the Thais are beginning, and they have their own, like we were talking at lunch, Bradley, the railroad ministry owns the right of way. And so you can deal with the Thai government and the rail ministry without at least displacing loads of people and so forth. There are problems there, and the Thai rail ministry doesn't necessarily want to it wants to control development, but China, to finance it, wants development rights for commercial sales and stores and factories and along the way. And so there have been negotiations over that. There's a negotiations over the interest rate. So what I'm trying to say is China's neighbors are not all either victimized by everything that goes on, or inadvertently become victims. They are making choices, and everybody's playing a game on when do we sign on to this, that, and I think the Thais will move along. Now, another whole set of questions is what kinds of things interrupt this logic? And this is going to unfold over decades, and all sorts of things. But I'll just, it'll signal to you the direction I'm going. One person's in China said, you know, dealing with these more democratic systems, like any, I think he had in mind Malaysia, that's complicated to call it democratic, but nonetheless, Thailand, he had that in mind. Really difficult to deal with democracies because they're so pluralized. And the government says one thing, but there are all these citizen groups that create all these problems. It's a real problem to deal with democracies, right? You can imagine that being a kind of Chinese view on the subject. So on the other hand, if you have a tightly authoritarian government. On the other hand, you have a more potent negotiator. If they want to resist, like in Vietnam, they're more capable of resisting. If, on the other hand, you go like Najib or Mahathir in Malaysia, they have a certain amount of capacity within the system and they can move the system that way. So the point is the nature of the political system, each of these cases, and it changes. You go from Mahathir to Najib, who's really close to the Chinese, financially corrupt wise, and he's willing to do what the Chinese want. And then Mahathir gets elected, throws Najib out, and says to the Chinese, all projects stop until you renegotiate a fair deal with us, which the Chinese did. Fair. And they modified the route, displaced fewer people, and so forth. So what I'm really saying is this book is really about how Asia is a real community of nations that have very complex internal decision-making systems, and that the Chinese, as big as they are, as dynamic as they are, have a lot of sway. I would just end by saying that, and I don't want to sound naive, and if we had more time, maybe the questions you'll ask in that direction, is that the Chinese have a vision, and we should understand, when I say the Chinese, I don't mean all Chinese, and I certainly, there's much debate, as I already said, about whether what infrastructure should we be building where, in China as opposed to Laos or whatever. But the question that I think the Chinese, in the end have is, what's in it for China? What's the undergirding motivation here? And the undergirding motivation, as one very old friend in the Academy of Sciences at Tsinghua that was particularly an advisor to Jiang Zemin and Hu Jintao, he said, oh, in the old days, all roads led to Rome. The future, all roads are leading to China. And if you look at the BRI and its six corridors of infrastructure, I think that's the undergirding version and vision. And that isn't primarily, I think, military domination. It's economic prowess and creating incentives for people to comply with Chinese interests, both economic, strategic, foreign policy, and others. There's a kind of far-seeing, as one person said to me, it's hard to get rich in a poor region. If China's going to continue to grow and its growth rate is falling, broadly speaking, we need to develop new markets and expand our market, and not only for our cement and our steel to build all this and sell them the technology, but we all have to develop economically together. Now, I'm not saying it's a benign vision, but I think it's not an unwise vision. And so, I think what the Chinese are presenting to us as a national challenge is, how are we going to respond to this? China's already the leading trade partner of everybody in Southeast Asia, right? Now, money doesn't determine everything, but it sure determines a lot, or at least influences a lot. And so what I guess this is, I'm not going to speak for my co-authors here, but I think the U.S. has a lot of rhetoric. But I'll give you just a close with an observation from interviews in Cambodia. I went into those interviews in Cambodia because one of the routes could go through Cambodia, Phnom Penh on to Bangkok. And incidentally, Bangkok sees its future as the Chicago of South and East Asia, India, Bangkok, Vietnam on the east-west axis, China all the way to Singapore on the north-south axis. So everybody's got their dream here. The Chinese have their dream, but the Thais have their dream. So the U.S., back to Cambodia, U.S. sees and I saw when I went there, my perception was that Cambodia's in the pocket of the Chinese and that, you know, they're bad actors and they constrain ASEAN and do all this kind of stuff we would not prefer they do. There's that reality. But when I was there interviewing and went down to Sihanoukville, among other things, and first of all, they were afraid to let us go to Sihanoukville because of the kind of insecure travel that's necessary to get there. But when you get there, it's a town full of casinos that Chinese, overseas Chinese have taken over, and the Cambodians are really upset about this, cultural-wise, just, you know, crime-wise, prostitution-wise, I mean, name the wise, and there are plenty of them. And what several Cambodians said is, you know, we'd like closer economic relations with the United States. We don't want to be driven into the arms of China, although partly we see leaning towards China as a way to protect us from the Vietnamese, which was part of their calculation. But we would move closer to you if you offered us anything. Well, what do you offer us? Sanctions for human rights and all of this. You leave us no choice. So the US can have its fears, its strategic fears, its anxieties, but what are we actually prepared to do? What are we able to do? I mean, given our economic and political circumstance, can we forge the consensus, make available the resources to compete with China? And you don't compete again, you don't work against something with nothing. So what's our something gonna be? And so I think we have to realize the ambition of what the Chinese are trying to accomplish, the sophistication that they're bringing to it, and quit belly aching and get to work. I mean, that'd be my late afternoon Friday kind of simplification. So I'm not trying to, you know, it is what it is, in my view. And it's complicated. The Chinese aren't the white hats in this situation, but they're not uniformly the black hats either. And the people they're proposing to cooperate with have their constraints, but they also have their ability to resist. And so I think that's sort of what this book's about, without boring you chapter by chapter recitation. Have I spoken too little or too much?
Just right.
Just right. Goldilocks.
Well, thank you very much. I'll let you pick the questions, but let me get one to start off with. That is the rail thing from Singapore ultimately ends up in Duisburg, Germany, rather than simply in China. And I wonder, and of course, that is brought into the question by Putin's adventures in the Ukraine and the apparent trend toward a splitting of Eurasia into Europe and Asia. And I'm wondering how important that is for the overall picture. When you were talking in Laos and Bangkok and other places, was it mostly in terms of connecting to the Chinese domestic system or connecting via China to systems elsewhere?
Well, just on the latter, because I think I have a clearer answer to that. But was it the lure of China or China and beyond? Of course, every positive benefit you get by connecting to China is an incentive for one of the seven countries to hook up because they're bigger market. So I wouldn't say that Europe was the major goal and China was the pathway. I certainly wouldn't say that, but they're additive. And that is everybody has more incentive the bigger the system gets. And that applies in Southeast Asia. And China's just taken advantage of its position, its size, its economic dynamism. But undoubtedly for Southeast, I say undoubtedly, in my view, with little doubt, the main attraction is China. I mean, right? I mean, Europe's a mature economy and its middle class has a lot of
problems
country by country. So undoubtedly, China's the biggest. But the fact that China hooked into this larger system is an attraction. And, you know, if, you know, Central Asia begins to develop and so on. So people have a long view. So I don't think it's either or, but China's certainly the most immediate big potential. I think that's kind of totally clear. The Germany thing is interesting. I didn't mention this, but another way, you know, I did say Jiang Zemin and Hu Jintao built the system and Xi benefited. Well, Xi also did not dream up the idea of this network or this vision. Well, first of all, you go back to the 19th century and the French wanted to approach China from a soft underbelly to, there was the coastal penetration and unequal treaties and treaty ports and all that. But the French wanted to come into Yunnan thinking Sichuan, among other things, is this great untapped resource. So there was the French and there were the British in Burma and India that wanted to penetrate China. So Mahathir, when he asked, or when we interviewed him, which we had the opportunity to do, he said, and he's been a big promoter of this overall, even though it gets complicated, that he got the idea as a boy watching British trains go through his area, his home area. And he ascribed the motive to the British. You know, they may have been colonialists and imperialists, but they occasionally had good ideas, and this is one of them. And then the Japanese, of course, it's interesting, and I tell the story here, that the U.S. was sinking all of this Japanese during World War II, sinking it, you know, the bottom of the South China Sea. And they wanted to build this railroad system, bridge on River Kwai kind of stuff, down to Singapore to move freight without the maritime vulnerability. So you have the Japanese. And then Mahathir comes along in the 90s and asks Zhu Rongji, will you support, will you finance railroad development for us? Zhu Rongji almost laughed and said, we're going to build railroads in China before we build them in Malaysia, right? Someday, maybe this will be a relevant discussion, but that day is not now. Well, then you had this internal development, Chinese highways, Chinese, there's all that infrastructure. And so the day came very rapidly where Zhu Rongji wasn't the one in power by 2010, 2015. But that's a remarkable from, we can't conceive of even helping little Malaysia, to we're gonna build three lines all the way to Singapore. So, I mean, that's pretty interesting. And it's not malign. It can be put to malign purposes, malign means, extortion, corruption, all of that exists, as it did with our transcontinental railroad. But you got to ask eventually, does something do more harm or good? And my guess is the knock-on effects of this vision being realized is going to transform this region. And it's going to build China into the center of that economic network. Now, as an American, and we propose in the book, we shouldn't have as our national mission frustrating everything China is trying to do. We should try to frustrate things China shouldn't be doing. So, but I think our competing vision ought to be building what I call balanced connectivity. If China's emphasizing the flow of everything north-south, why don't we work with India and Vietnam? I hesitate to say Burma, but it does lie in that track. Why don't we help create balanced alternatives and flows of resources rather than try to stop what I take to be a not bad Chinese idea, right? Now, a lot of people would say, well, I mean, that's a pretty naive view. China's our biggest strategic threat. We got to do what we got to do, right? Well, that's a whole other discussion, but it's not the direction we're going. We're saying, think about the needs of these countries and how we can relate to them in ways that are in our interest. make that the focus, our interests and development in the region, rather than just do what we can to throw sand in the Chinese gears, which in the end, if the Chinese have a decent policy, I'm not going to be able to throw enough sand in the gears. Does that even approach your answer or your question? Yes, sir.
Many questions because I really enjoyed it, but maybe a simple one. You said they got invited to Canada, Japan, France, and I think Sweden. Could you say briefly what they did with those four countries? What were the connections? What is your book?
Well, I think the answer is I have an idea, but the cooperation was so, a lot of it's proprietary. Firms don't like to talk in all great detail about what they're doing. And it wasn't the principal focus of, I felt like I had to give enough background to that China built the system and broadly speaking, how did it do? But there'd be a lot more research that I'd be very interested in seeing somebody really answer your question. But the key difficulties were first, basically, how do you keep a train moving at between 160 kilometers an hour and 350 miles per kilometers an hour? How do you keep it on the track? And there's a lot of technology in that. Secondly, how do you propel an engine? They call them EMUs in this industry. How do you develop the propulsion technology? And then there's how do you supply the power? And there's power transmission issues. Then there's switching technology. And that they initially had a big problem. I forget the year, was it 2011, 2012, something like that. A lot of people got killed in Wenzhou. Two of these high-speed trains ran into each other, just in parentheses on this topic. China has built a high-speed rail system that's as safe as any international airline. They did have that big collision. Great Leap Leo got blamed in part for it, but they made the changes and actually it's a remarkably safe system. There's a whole other, I don't mean to keep branching out, but there's so many things. This raises also the question of why do people like the Vietnamese actually wanted to go to the Japanese for strategic reasons because they don't want to be too dependent on China, but they ended up not doing anything except asking China to build the Hanoi metro system. And it was a disaster. But in any case, how Japan and China contest here is an interesting question. And as I said, so each country, the Canadians come into it through their company called Bombardier. And if you ride various subway systems around the world, actually, you'll see a lot of Bombardier equipment. It's often rolling stock and so forth. So a lot of these were particular systems, which meant the Chinese have to deal with a lot of suppliers who are skeptical and are afraid of losing their technology. But they're also afraid of missing the biggest market in the world. And so you can say their fear was exceeded by their greed, you know, in retrospect, in a sense, to the degree that they helped build a very big competitor. But you got to admire the Chinese. I mean, they came from nowhere, you know, frankly, on this technology and negotiated all these deals. But I think a great book could be written on how China negotiated with suppliers in a high technology area to part with their crown jewels and smile as they did. Is that even responsive to your? Yes.
Could I add an anecdote on this directly? Because I had a tour of the aircraft plant of Bombardier from one of the vice presidents a few years ago. And it's not a question. It was a question. This was aircraft rather than high-speed rail. But the thing was, what he emphasized was working together you know, it's not a question of giving the technology and then disappearing or selling the technology, and that's the deal. It was working together on this particular aircraft, and he was very proud to show me there were, you know, 30 Chinese engineers working in that lab, and they weren't simply applying, they were co-developing with the RDA on the implementation. They weren't simply applying Canadian technology. Bombardier, incidentally, as a useful fact, they invented the snowmobile.
So you can see it's an innovative company. And I think you're right to point out that, I mean, I put it in rather stark bipolar market for technology, never shall the twain meet, but there is a kind of co-development thing there. But this gets to that level of analysis I said needs more research. If you ask me what actually came out of such collaboration, I couldn't tell you, right? So I would add the codicil. I think what you're saying is right. I could give you no specific example, but that's probably my failing, not you know, the absence of such examples. I would just say, because this relates to the current developments in U.S.-China relations and China's relations with the West, the United States is adopting, and I can understand why, and in certain areas I would be supportive, but overall our policy is headed towards technology limitation in anything that could be very important to China. We are putting in barriers to technology transfer and investment in China in anything that looks like research and development, co-development of advanced technology. Maybe that'd be less important in high-speed rail than aircraft or pick your technologies. I don't know. But we are headed in a non-sharing direction. That is as clear as the nose on your face.
Yes, sir. I have a question about the feasibility of high-speed rail, 30,000 kilometers. I understand it's limited to passenger traffic. For countries in Southeast Asia, it may be more important to have freight lines.
Right.
And China has already sunk so much into Gaotie and has, to some extent, ignored the need for better freight lines, even within China?
Well, it's complicated because there is the high-speed system, and then there's what you'll call the traditional system. And part of the Chinese idea was to put passenger traffic on the high-speed network, freeing up space that used to be hauling people and pigs and everything else, and getting that for free. So the whole part of the book deals with the things that were in it for the Chinese to develop this system, which was to separate and create two corridors, because freight trains move slow and high-speed passenger traffic fast. And if you only have one track, the slowest guy on the track dictates the highest speed. So that you've hit on a very important thing. Now, but what you were saying, I thought, was that high speed is not so relevant for freight. I think that's true, but high value commodities, like if you got mangoes coming from Malaysia, you can't have them on a freight train. Oh, well, you may not.
Is Gaotia used for things like fruit and mangoes?
I don't have any figures, but I think the answer is yes. But how much of their available space they would devote that, I don't know. But I think the answer is more than zero. And high, just like FedEx, you don't move steel on FedEx, but you do high value commodities. So I think that's kind of the direction of answer on that. Now on the Southeast Asians, this gets to Chinese learning. Yes, China's pushing their Xiehe system, the Renaissance system. They're moving up speed. They're talking about moving things at 600 kilometers an hour in the future. I mean, that's what they're thinking about. So China is
building a more high-speed system. But they want to sell to people that are not in the position of China, whether size, density of population, closeness of cities, and so forth. So they are marketing their systems as much slower and more mindful of the freight need. Now, I don't know, we've only got the system to the Thai border here, but I think that the Chinese have shown they are listening to the market. And the market isn't for 350 kilometers in Southeast Asia. It's probably for 165 kilometers. Well, if you think the average train in Thailand was going at 30 kilometers, that's a five-time increase. So, you know, it's a lot of progress, even though it's half of what China's doing itself. I would just say, apropos of your question, I had a very interesting conversation in Jakarta with AHOC, the governor of Jakarta. At just this right moment, they were negotiating. And he said, look, we got our president off negotiating strategically with China and building this line from Jakarta to Bandung. Good for him. But these trains that he's talking about with China are moving so fast, they can't stop within the city limits of Jakarta. They have to start stopping way before they get to, or slowing down. Just like you go to Shanghai and that from Pudong, you're only at top speed for about 2 minutes on a 17 minute trip. So he said, we'd be much better off with conventional train GE makes. He even said GE. But I'm not going to argue with my president. So just between you and me, I wish he wasn't buying this, right? So this is all true. But it raises the question, is China learning from its interaction in the world? We have this kind of sense that it's this authoritarian robot that can't learn. And heaven knows there are enough examples that sometimes make you wonder. But I think it's unrealistic, let's say it's not appreciating. When China puts its mind to things, it can learn. It makes it sound more unitary than it is. But does that kind of address your question?
Okay. So you would not consider the 30,000 kilometers to be a misallocation of capital? Most of those lines do not even pay for their upkeep.
Well, this is a fascinating question, and I don't mean I answered it, but I addressed it. And I said, now you've brought us to the realm of cost-benefit analysis. Well, I'm not an expert in cost-benefit analysis, but I think I looked at it. And well, first of all, it's easy to make cost-benefit analysis come out the way you want it to come, right? First of all, you have to list, what are the things I'm weighing against what things? Is that list comprehensive and fair or not? Different. What you always find in cost-benefit analysis is when somebody wants something, they then make the benefits of it look great and they downplay the cost or how long it's going to take to build or what's going to cost. So time and cost. And I use an example in the book. The big dig in Boston. Started out estimate to cost $2 billion. Final cost, I forget exactly, it's in the book, I think $15 billion, and it took 25 years to build. And the first day it opened, piece of concrete fell out of the ceiling and killed a lady going through in a car. So, you know, and everybody wants their cost-benefit analysis when you're in the adoption phase. Do we do it or don't? You can just count on the opponents that are going to exaggerate the cost and the proponents are going to minimize the cost. So I don't mean to say never do cost benefit analysis, just go by your left elbow. But to think that cost benefit analysis is the last word.
What do you think the planners minimized the costs when it came to planning for Gaotia?
Oh, and then this is the whole question of opportunity costs, I think. In other words, you're investing all this money in railroads. What aren't you investing in, right? Is that your...
Well, also, on my understanding, there are only two lines that make money. between Shanghai and Beijing, and the rest of it is like national.
Can I reverse this and then ask you some questions?
Please.
Yes. Okay, so as I understand it, there are two lines, quote, making money, which I think when you say making money, you mean the ticket revenues match the cost revenue costs of running it. But I would just say, but is ticket revenue the only gain you get from moving people by train fast? Is revenue the total gain? Is it, if it doesn't, that sounds like a really free market kind of thing. Well, it doesn't pay for itself. By definition, the market said it's not worth it. End of story. How much coal isn't going to be burned by air travel? What's the carbon consumption or output into the system of trains versus alternative forms? Cars. How many highways are you going to have to build if you don't build these? Do you see what I mean? So what I'm saying is, I think you, about public infrastructure, have to see it as something more than ticket sales. If you only look at the ticket sales, a free market guy like me would say, well, the market spoke. It's not willing to pay for what the true costs of running it are. All I would say is I think the gains, the gains of high-speed rail are enormous. And therefore, I'd almost be in the position, whatever it cost, building it was worth it because it will become more costly, the more dense, the more cities, the more displacement. And so if China was ever going to do it, there's no day better than today. You see what I mean? Now, there's a lot of squishy thinking behind what I just said. I will admit it, but politics is about deciding squishy things. I mean, otherwise we just have the engineers tell us what, right? Or the economists or something. Am I clear? Or you think wrong?
No. There are national reasons for making investments which really don't make much sense from an economic point of view. I mean,
right.
The bridge in India that's going to connect Kashmir to the rest of the country is a good example of such an uneconomic investment.
Right. And we built bridges to nowhere, right, in Alaska.
So the question really is, okay, you have this national impetus to do something really fantastic, but that still leaves the question of freight traffic. It also leaves the question of Chinese people themselves electing to take slow buses rather than pay the high ticket price.
Sure.
On the
Gautier. Right. Doesn't, and I just would say, just on the freight thing, Thailand, the rail ministry, as I said, controls the right of way. So Thailand already has a pre-existent conventional system that they're going to upgrade and use for freight. And then I think if it develops as I see, the Chinese will, with ties, build a parallel system for passengers. So Thailand has an option that maybe not everybody else has. So each of these seven countries will, with it, but on the other hand, you in the end have to connect at the border, right? So there'll be different purposes and designs along the way in each of these countries to accommodate their needs or their realities. But ultimately, it's limited by the need to connect. But I don't disagree with you, but I think the Chinese, would China be better off if it threw its lot with the highway buses? Even buses aren't exactly non-polluting, but be that as it may, cars. Could, as we found, you build a road and they generate enough cars to make it in a few years as congested as the pre-existing system. And yes, the ticket prices are high. Also, I would say another externality. In developing its domestic system, China developed its equivalent of Boeing aircraft. in a sense. It used that domestic investment to create a global export. Now, it remains to be seen, are other people going to buy it? Are they going to buy Japanese or German or whatever? That's all to be determined. But China sees this as a globally competitive industry. And so in a sense, it looks at that domestic experience as building something it didn't have. And the Chinese ask themselves, do we want to be known for making shoes for the for eternity, or are we going to be in the big leagues here, right? Well, as you can rightly imagine, the Chinese aren't going to be aren't happy just making shoes. So it, that's a gain. I mean, in the mentality, the calculus. Yes, we lost money domestically, but boy, we're going to get it back in the form. Now, they may not. They may fail. But that's entrepreneurship, right?
I mean, coming back to this question, I think there must be something more than economic benefits. If you see, and it's good that you brought up the French intention of developing to China. But in 1920, Sun Yat-sen had a map in his International Development Act about railroads.
Ah.
So it's not just the Communist Party. Sun Yat-sen had that vision.
Good point.
So it's perhaps more than economy. It's a China dream, perhaps,
uh-huh.
that comes from the 20th century and not the economic benefits. But at the same time, there are lots of itinerant merchants, traders, who are moving along. So it will benefit them as well as goods. Back and forth. And for me, because there are two options here. One, you ask, what's there for China about this? And I would ask, perhaps you have written about this in the book, what's there for Yunnan in particular? Because Yunnan for a long time has been trying to develop ties to both Southeast Asia and South Asia. And the DCIM was with India and Bangladesh. So I think Yunnan as itself, as a province where Kunming is located, is trying to benefit from this connectivity that it wants to link with Southeast Asia.
Right.
So I would ask you about what's there for Yunnan in this. And the second part is about the ASEAN, right? The Chinese entry into ASEAN, people have argued, has divided ASEAN. So Cambodia and Laos are not similar to other places.
Right.
Laos, as you know, uses RMB, uses R from China. So maybe it's easier to use Laos as one of the key points.
A stalking horse.
Yes, and so my question for that is, as a railway project, undivided ASEAN, which initially you could see from the Cambodia-ASEAN meeting, clearly Cambodia didn't want to side with other ASEAN countries, sided with China. So I wonder if the railway project is bringing the ASEAN countries, some of them at least, together, or is there still a caution, certainly from Singapore, about the railroad project?
Well, I think just on the last, Singapore seems kind of ambivalent about this, and that's all because they're very strategically worried about China. They are at the end of the line, and in some sense, if there isn't this connectivity, Singapore port is more important than if suddenly Malaysia and all those ports get opened up. So every country's got its own calculus in Singapore. So I'll come back to ASEAN, but my initial reaction to your question is just as I said. You raised, I won't say the key question, but a very key question. And that is, I said, one of my interests was the politics of this. And by that, I didn't mean just in Southeast Asia or just between Southeast Asia and China. I meant in China. And this raises the issue that we speak of China as a holistic entity, as a single-minded work. But a whole part of this is the entrepreneurship of different bureaucracies in China, different provinces, different localities. And Yunnan is a perfect example throughout this. Yunnan is pretty isolated if you just look at a map of China. And that's why they were amenable in a sense to connecting earlier with the French and the British and whoever'd connect. Because from their viewpoint, Guangzhou is a lot further away
potentially than some areas to its south. And so these countries look at their economic situation, their geographic situation, and say, where's the opportunity? Everybody in China's looking for opportunity or threat. And so Yunnan has been very active in pursuing this. They had to fight with Guizhou over what would be the gateway line, the hub, or Guangxi, I misspoke. So Guangxi. But the point is the provinces were fighting who gets the key catbird seat here. Well, through things, process, I don't know. But there was politics in that process. You
could add a detail on Yunnan that really illustrates your point. That is, the French built the railroad in 1910 from Haiphong through Hanoi,
right,
up the Red River to Kunming, cost something like 30,000 lives, and thinking they were going to get to Sichuan. Well, Yunnan not connected to anywhere at that time. All they got was to Yunnan.
Yeah,
and Yunnan wasn't much, except it became a big opium growing. And so that, it's the same 1910 year, was the development of the Hong Kong Canton Railroad. Now that turned out to be a useful thing because it did connect at least to Pearl River Delta or Pearl River Valley.
And two things, you provided me some data now, I recall, on exactly this topic when I got there. So publicly thank you for that. The other line that made sense I found from other research was Haiphong Hanoi.
Oh yeah.
So a few, but basically it was it was a money loser. And it was interesting. Why did the French want to lose money on railroads here? Because the French steel industry had excess steel and wanted to sell it somewhere, and here it was, so they convinced the French government to, in effect, subsidize the steel industry by La Grandeur de la France, right?
The company that built the Eiffel Tower.
Yes, right. I'm sure that's oversimplified, but it's heading in the right direction. Yes, ma'am.
I'm from Vietnam.
Oh,
and we need.
Have I misstated anything about Vietnam?
But actually, the whole story is, and the politics of that is totally there. I remember that the time that we had problems in the way like Chinese persuade Vietnam to join, and we have obstacle with like nationalism, and people go to strike and demonstration, and of course this. The very clever way that how China make suppression of like killing the strikes. Domestically. And so when we mentioned about Haiphong, Kunming, Haiphong and Hanoi corridor, that's also a really political bonus.
Right.
But I think it's more than beyond the corridor, like railway is still there. It's also related to why China can go to South China Sea.
Yes. Oh, that's a very good.
Yes.
Yes. Well, thank you. Let me, you mentioned South China Sea, and I want to get back to that. But I did say that China building the Hanoi metro system,
yes,
I'll say it that way, was it, I think I used the word disaster. Is that true?
Yeah, nothing there.
Yeah, right. Yes, it was safety-wise, cost-wise, time schedule-wise, disaster. So, but thank you for your addition. You remind me that there's so many, what I love about this is it speaks to, I love my book, I mean, the topic, is it speaks to so many things. Just it connects to so many realms. One of the big kind, if you ask, I think you said it's a dead issue, railroad through Vietnam. I never say dead as in forever, as far as I can see, it's dead. So we don't need to argue. But one of the big contradictions is China's foreign policy in the South China Sea is alienating all the people they're trying to convince commercially to integrate. So I say to the Chinese, you got to decide, is it your economic agenda or some strategic agenda that you're going to have driving? And as long as your strategic agenda is driving your policy, don't expect all of the countries to your south that are intimidated to reward you with being more connected. Is that right? So its foreign policy is in this region, in part, undermining its economic. That's maybe the way to put it.
Yeah, that's, I think we can explore further about how the U.S. Foreign policies and that in that issue, South China Sea, and it somehow like not so success because China still know their power. In the-
right, but just ask, I'm an American. So from an American point of view, how long is the U.S. going to supply the guns and how long are the Chinese going to get the contracts? And how long are we going to be happy with that situation? The United States' principal purpose in the region is to provide security, which I take to be important. But China has an economic vision that over the long run, and that long run might be 10, 15, 50 years, but is headed in an intelligent direction. They may not be very efficient. Their reform policy may be operating against it. But in the end, China's building for the long-term economic and industrial capacity, and we're bankrolling the security. I mean, I just think that's, I don't know what I'd do about it if I were king for a day, but I don't think this is.
You'd change it.
Huh?
You would change it.
Well, I'd at least ask, how could we change it? I don't start with an answer, but I think there's a problem that the long run, frankly, I think economic power generates coercive power and it generates intellectual power. And if you're not putting enough attention to the economic dimension, you're ultimately weakening your other instruments of policy. I mean, that'd be it.
Yes, sir. I have a question that comes back to your earlier conversation about the cost benefit. Because the Japanese built a very similar high-speed rail system over a longer time period. But their first line was very rational, made a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Big population centers.
That was the one going south to Kyoto and Nara and all
the way to Fukuoka, the Pacific coastline. Mm-hmm. But then for political reasons, they connected every different corner of Japan to their high-speed rail. And before they were done, they had a huge financial problem where the ticket revenue was supposed to pay for all this debt, but only this one line was paying for itself.
Right.
All the others, eventually they had to recognize they were never going to pay off that debt,
right,
and the government had to absorb it.
Either. Right.
So my question is basically, I mean, this must be true of the line to Tibet. But how, you know, what is the proportion of lines that were built in this 30,000 kilometers of politically done things that will never pay for themselves versus things that actually are rational in terms of connecting major cities that will potentially over time pay back the debt?
Well, you got a lot of sub questions in there. Tibet, I agree with you, will never pay, because if we're talking about the TAR, and that gets to what Tibet is, but the TAR, what has fewer than 3 million people. So that's what you need to know. But it is a way to move troops. And the PLA is a very big, People's Liberation Army is a very big presence, largely unseen. And I've been to Tibet twice, I've seen a lot of aspects, but I've seen prisons, but nothing to do with the PLA, driven by a few garrisons about which the Chinese are tight-lipped. But it's a big presence. So I think in the Chinese idea, and you'll remember that we were talking about the Indian border and with China, you have Ladakh and this road going in from China through Ladakh, contested area with India, into Tibet. And that's entirely, how do we get the PLA into Tibet? And so, well, India sees it as its border problem. China sees it as strategic importance of controlling Tibet. And I think that way back when, Zhou Enlai actually offered, you give us Ladakh, we'll give you Mayan on the eastern side of the border. So I think Tibet will never be ticket revenue and freight and anything else you think about generate revenue to justify what must have been, they were going across frozen tundra and everything else. They had to develop rail cars with pressurized cabins. So I just assume without any figures, never. But that's not the benefit that they think. And as I said, there's ticket revenue and then there's benefit. And getting the PLA into control Tibet is a benefit in the Chinese view. And they're willing to pay almost anything to do it. It may be that once they're more secure in their ability to reach Tibet, maybe they can be more flexible on Ladakh. I wouldn't bet on it. That's a theory. In theory, they ought to think about that, but I don't think they will.
There'll never be a railroad along that line. I've driven that road.
The one, you mean the Ladakh?
Ladakh Road.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, that's
My driver got sick, so I actually did have to drive.
Oh, gee.
The highest road.
How many miles did you go on?
It's that part of it's about 600 miles from Ali to.
Where did you stay?
Hotcar. We picked up. He picked up a PLA officer who needed a ride, and in gratitude, he talked the next PLA base that we went to drop him off, but he said we could stay over there. So I have been embedded with the PLA in the student area in Ladakh. And you want to see the height of security there? I asked him where the restrooms were. I don't have restrooms. Army base, latrines. And he said, oh, they're out the main gate. I said, well, what if you happen to go in the night? He said, we don't lock the door.
Well, I would wager to say you're the only American who ever slept with the PLA in Ladakh. I don't know, did we lose the train of thought?
Can't go any lower.
Yes,
any of those lines that take you to out-of-way places in Japan, they forced people to take the Shinkansen by closing down the slower lines. So now a lot of people go on overnight buses.
But just getting back to this cost-benefit thing, and I don't know much, frankly, about the politics in Japan of the financing and all that, so big thing I should learn more about. But I would say, just from what I've heard and what I understand, is just the fact that that one line or two lines in Japan, quote, break even or make money. Still, if that was the only thing I knew, I would not necessarily be convinced that the system was misguided. First of all, there are a whole spectrum of possibilities. There may be lines that truly are, by any calculation, misguided. But there may be others that have positive spinoffs that are not measured by ticket revenue, but would be conceded, at least by a majority of people, to be, well, worth it. So these aren't dichotomous. Usually if you want to get a legislature to adopt something, you have to give benefits to very different kind of constituencies, log rolling. So once you get into in a democratic system, trying to get an appropriation for infrastructure, often it gets bigger and bigger. It says, well, I'll support that if you'll support the bridge in my district, right? And so there's a kind of in democratic particularly, or and even more authoritarian systems, you try to get a big coalition big enough to spend that amount of money, you're making a lot of promises, and the economists aren't in the room when you're doing it. Does that make sense? Or
absolutely. But of course, I mean, we have to think about demographic recessions coming up for China too, and what that would mean for their rail system.
So is it wrong to say that this is not really an economic project, but rather a political project?
This?
No, the building of the railroad to Southeast Asia, just like the Tibet Road. It's a political agenda, not an economic.
Well, I wouldn't put it that way. I don't mean just no. But I think big things happen for many reasons. That's what I really think. And when big things happen, it means there were many reasons. Some are strategic. Some are fear that the U.S. would stop, you know, maritime transportation. Some are because China has this huge cement and steel industry that it used to build this equivalent to the Eisenhower highway system, and then the rail system. And now what do we do with all of the workers and cement and steel industries? So some of it's about export. Some of it is how does China develop a new competitive industries? You know, America had Boeing. I keep using that because it's a driving technology. You develop that industry, you develop plastics, metallurgy, propulsion technology, control. It has backward linkages, right? So I think big things happen for many reasons. And this is what is to me kind of disappointing about when we talk about China. We talk about China as one mind with one purpose, and that's it. I mean, I'm exaggerating. That's kind of my feeling. Yeah,
the industrial policy bit is very interesting because, of course, China has had a very activist industrial policy. And of course, it's not the first one in East Asia. It's not going to be the last one. But it sort of gets to the point that you were talking about excess capacity in steel, cement, all of those things. Now, when you're thinking about it from the other side, from the recipient side's perspective,
recipient meaning
of Chinese,
in like Laos,
yeah. Not Laos per se, but Malaysia, Thailand, etc. If they want to have a more activist industrial policy, which sort of tries to bring in some of these things inside, isn't that a big challenge? And the way that things have worked as far as the BRI is concerned, even with the large big ticket items, that's the main challenge, because you have all of these systems that are being built. And yet the sort of linkages that you talk about, and there's a lot of literature in the FDI, you know, sort of genre, which talks about the lack of linkages as far as these FDI, you know, from advanced countries in these developing countries are concerned. So in a sense, then the sort of lack of linkages has a problem in terms of sustainability of such big ticket items as well. So I know that in Malaysia, they're establishing a rolling stock plant.
Yes, right.
But there's nothing in, for example, Indonesia, there's nothing. In other parts of Southeast Asia, there's nothing as well. And the problem gets worse as you move away from Southeast Asia, because I do think the linkages between Southeast Asia and China are much more dynamic, right, with global value chains. But as you sort of move away from Southeast Asia, they're much weaker. So isn't that a problem as far as the design? Well,
I think it's also true they have problems of this kind in Southeast Asia, in the countries I'm talking about. So I'm just saying the problem you identified includes the seven countries I looked at, but would apply to more. Yes. So I think you have a problem, and that is that China would come in with its technology and so forth, but what are the development benefits for the local country? Or local country, or the localities through which this goes.
Firms.
And firms, yes. So, but the different countries have different capacity. Thailand, I would say, is a high capacity country to deal with China, partly because it's further up the industrial scale than some. But it also openly says, we're going to have Japan build some of this system, even if it doesn't connect to the Chinese system, because we have some routes that can be handled by a system that doesn't need to do anything with the Chinese. So we're going to bring the Japanese in and use them as negotiating leverage against the Chinese. So, and Indonesia, incidentally, used, Japan thought it was going to get the contract. And then China came in and offered them a better deal. And Indonesia, as I understood, said, okay, we'll go with a cheaper deal. But the big prize isn't Bandung to Jakarta. The big prize is Bandung to Surabaya over on the Bali Straits. That's the contract everybody wants. And China's not sure it's going to get it. And if it behaves badly or doesn't perform well, or however you want to put it, it may be the Japanese that build the next link. So the capacity, it's just my theme being that these aren't all victims in all regards, right? They have some leverage. But, and also that's why I mentioned ASEAN. And then there was this question about the complications in ASEAN and Cambodia and Laos, all true enough. But ASEAN does have a connectivity plan, and it includes rails. And so these countries can refer to that. And ultimately, as I say, they have to link up with each other. So even if Laos is weak, I mean, what the Thais want matter, because they have to link up with this, right? So you get these back channel negotiations. Well, if we build the railroad to here, will you build to here, right? So I just find it fascinating, because I think this is a clearer vision of how the world works, which is what I'm actually interested in. It doesn't mean I've got exactly the right picture, all the facts straight, or I didn't miss a lot of facts. I confess to probably all those problems. But in the end, I think it's a realistic picture. Or if your alternative is what Xi Jinping says goes, if that's your vision, it's not my vision. I want to make sure everybody gets a chance. This young lady there and here.
I'm really interested in the project that, because like I just came from a conference that focused on like—
You came from where?
A conference that focused on sculptures, and it really mentioned about like in the 1970s when LA built the railroads, and they invite artists to like build the public art along the communities who were affected by the railway. So I'm wondering whether like Chinese government or other like governmental fundings for the art projects along the infrastructures, constructions.
Well, you know, that's interesting. And that is the first time anybody asked me that. I'll confess, the first time I ever thought about it was 5 seconds ago. So I know, but it's undoubtedly a real issue. Like, once you've got these stations, what's going to be in them? Right? Or these development areas. So good question. I unfortunately have nothing I can add that you don't already know. Yes, ma'am.
You said that China is now kind of scaling down its Belt and Road Initiative, so at least more conscious about how to broadcast it. I wonder, I would appreciate your insights on what's going on and what kind of props this type of rethinking about how to sell the initiative to the world.
Well, I agree with your premise that China's scaling back. And I've actually expected that for about, I will say, 5 years. And not because I'm particularly prescient, but because a Chinese official came into my office one day and was bemoaning. His job was to go around the world selling VR art. And he says, you know, Chinese, I need to tell you, but Chinese are real people with real views. Now, they don't always have the opportunity to express them or choose not to. But he came in and it's just, at first I almost didn't believe what he had to say, but I believed it more as I saw. And what he said is, we have a leader, Xi Jinping, going all over the world. And everywhere he goes, he's promising $50 billion. We don't have the technical people. We don't have the resources. We have domestic needs. Our problem is too many people want our projects and we can't meet the demand this guy's creating. And he was sort of saying, what do you do? I said, maybe get a new leader, but be that as it may, that was, you know, his view. So now what's happened is, of course, growth has continued to slow, broadly speaking, in China. There are two ways to look at it. Yes, any big economy, the bigger it gets, the harder it becomes to maintain a high growth rate in the double digits. You know, for 40 years, China was 9.8% compound annual growth. No, everybody said that can't go on forever. It went on longer than many thought. But China's now, there's a big argument about what growth is. Is it 4%, 3%, 2%? There seems to be a competition to who can credibly say the lowest growth rate. So I don't know, but that's the direction. So if you have a lower growth rate, there's a lot more you can do when you're growing at nearly 10% a year than you can do when you're growing at 4%. And also inequality is becoming progressively worse in China, which is creating pressures to adjust. China's rapidly growing demographically, so aging population requires more long-term curative care that's basically not productive in many economic respects. And so growth, big problem. Demographic aging, big problem. And then there's pushback. You've had Tsinghua professors writing public letters that all this export of high-speed rail is not the thing China should be doing, or at least not financing it the way it is. If they could export it and people paid in cash, and be a different story, but that's not the story. So yes, I think it's scaling back. And you know, there's a storyline developing about Xi, that his ambitions are creating more problems than solutions. And there's a kind of idea that, you know, I would say I have a revisionist idea. And that is, Jiang Zemin was a pretty damn good leader. I mean, and I don't just mean what's happened, but he started the Go West campaign. He started the Go Global campaign. He talked about bringing entrepreneurs, playing a greater role in the party. He may have not always seemed to be the most serious leader given how he interpersonally interacted. But I think if you look at the big strategic decisions, with the exception of Falun Gong and Tibet and some very important exceptions. But I think he also set China on some productive courses. So at best we can say it's a mixed record. But yes, I think China will slow down and be less ambitious on this. But it will do. I mean, I don't think it's tossed its vision of connectivity out the window, but it may be more selective in what it does and do so in smaller bite sizes. That would be my expectation. I'd be interested in what you think. What do you think?
It's a maybe part of the learning process as well. As they learn how complex it is, there's kind of lack of knowledge structure for preparing China's penetration into all parts of the world. So maybe China realizes it takes time to learn and it's that great moment to slow down a little bit. But I didn't think of the growth and the aging domestic factor also play a role.
Yeah.
Like I say, big things happen for many reasons. But remember, Japan coming out of World War II, it was a low-cost producer of umbrellas for bar drinks. I mean, in fact, Japan had what early on said made in USA. They didn't put the dots between USA because they wanted not to be clear. Japan wasn't always seen as the high quality, leading, innovative producer. You believe that, Brantley?
I can imagine it, sure.
Yeah. So I'm saying that China has a learning experience shouldn't be surprising.
I would like to have another matters to discuss, like how can China and the other international finance institution work together? Because I don't have statistics here, but what I observe is that the IFI, such as like IDB in the region, plays much stronger and active role in lending the governments.
Uh-huh.
But yeah, the finance could be from China through those institutions. And then the government, because they have kind of a joint finance and stuff like that, so they borrow more and more. And the governments believe that by investing and borrowing in infrastructure, it also helped to maintain the high growth rate.
Right.
So the booming of lending credits to countries, even with a lower interest rate.
Well, so your question.
The question is that.
No, I was going to say your question betrays you know more about the subject than I do. I'll start with that. But I do have a response. Two responses. One is you didn't mention AIIB, the Asia Investment Infrastructure Bank. And the US decided to not go into that. I think it's a worthy question. Was that a good decision for us? First of all, the charter of the AIIB was written by an American. And she had been the legal counsel for the World Bank. And the original Chinese idea was to have an international standard organization and so forth. The United States was afraid it would give China too much influence and China would dominate it and so forth. But I think it's worthy of asking, was that a correct decision? Would we not be better off playing an important role in a meaningful organization? So I would just say that's in this zone one thing to say. Secondly, I think there's a change in the world, has been a change in the World Bank and the related development institutions. For many years, particularly after the Russians built the Aswan Dam, that was not, I think people felt, a wise investment, ecologically damaging, not a good project. And of course, more attention always got paid over time in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s to displacement by big infrastructure, whether it was cultural displacement, people having to move, effects of building dams, and then it spreads disease through irrigation. Anyway, the idea became that human rights was not always served in its broadest sense by big infrastructure. And World Bank moved away from that, and they began to talk about education and human resource development, less intrusive, or at least less disruptive thing. Well, education can be pretty disruptive. Anyway, in that direction. And it's only with the Chinese push on global infrastructure that the US and the World Bank and so on are saying, we got to get in this game. So you see, you may have your misgivings about how China does things, but ask yourself, would China be so active in Africa if
the US or others had been involved over the years. I mean, China's moved into vacuums. And we have to ask ourselves, should we be operating in those vacuums or not? Some people would say, well, if the Chinese want to make bad investments in Africa and Southeast Asia, let them, more power to them. Let them exhaust themselves on inefficient projects. There's a big school of thought like that. Well, it's a judgment question. But my guess is at root, China is the most economically salient to the most people. China's going to have the most influence.
Well, we're out of time. Let me end with one short question. It turns us to the railroad and the rivers of iron.
That is.
So when do you think the railroad's going to reach Singapore?
Well, there are three lines.
Yeah.
Right. So I have no idea, but I bet it will be the central line that's first. And if you ask, it could stop at Malaysia and not go to Singapore. It could stop at Bangkok and not go south. So lots of uncertainties, but if you just say, I would say, I expect them to central line, get to Singapore in 2030 to 2040. I'll give you something like that. I don't think this is pie in the sky.
Okay.
Now, it may be that getting through Vietnam's pie in the sky and going through Burma, there'll probably be a line over to the coast because of oil and so forth. So you might have a partial line on that western side. So but that's what I mean. This is politics. What's the order of things? How far is it going to go? What are going to be its terms? Who's going to benefit? Is it going to move freight or passengers? How fast is it going to go? These are all political decisions. Or is it going to go at all, right? I mean, it's possible. I suppose things could stop at Nung Khai, right where they are. In which case, I think that will have been a bad investment for China. It makes sense the more it connects.
Well, thank you very much, Mike.